Well, good morning, Hope Church. How's everyone doing? I hope you have had the best week so far. My name is Joshua Thomas, and I'm just super excited to be with you today. I'm excited to welcome you. If you are our first-time guest here today, we are super happy to see you. We're excited for you to get connected into the life of our church. And the easiest way to do that, if you're watching us online right now, you can scan that QR code that's going to come up on your screen. That'll help you get connected. But if you're in person and you are a first-time guest outside, we have this really cool connection tent set up. We have a gift we want to give you, some people to meet to help you get plugged in to the life of our church. We've got some cool things coming up in the next couple of weeks here. This Wednesday, if you are a middle school or high school student, we have our first What Up Wednesday event. It's going to be here at the church from 6 to 7:30. We're going to be doing a color war, which means you need to wear a white t-shirt because we have this really awesome color powder that's going to get all over your clothes and probably not come out in the wash, and that makes it super fun. So you're going to come, we're going to have Kona ice, and it's going to be a blast. Next week is really cool too. We're not going to be here in the building. All online next week. So next week for the 4th of July weekend, we have a really cool service planned for you that's going to be all online so that you can watch it on your way to the beach or whatever you might be doing celebration-wise for that day. We are super excited to be with you. If you would, stand to your feet, and we'd love for you to meet some people around you. Learn someone's name that you maybe have never met before, and then we're going to jump into worship.
You stepped into my In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Faithful, why don't you let him know right now? Why don't you just let him know right now, whether you're at home or in person today? Let's just pray together. God, you have been so faithful. God, we are so thankful for who you are. God, you are a great God. God, we don't deserve your goodness. God, we lose our given week and a given month and a given day, God, of just all the many blessings, of all the things that you do in our life. God, and just today, we want to stop in this moment, God, and just reflect on your goodness. God, may we count our incredible blessings. And may we see you as the good father that you truly, truly are. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. You guys can be seated. Well, good morning, Hope Church family. How are we doing today? We're doing well. We're doing good. Everybody excited to be here. I want to welcome everybody that's in person today and everybody at Hope Church online. We're going to dive right into it today because we are in the seventh week of a teaching series called Fuel Cost. We've been talking in this teaching series about how to redeem some things that God has given to us. Redeem our relationships, redeem our values, redeem our time, redeem our families, redeem rest, redeem some things in life, not just for any unknown reason, but we're called to take hold of them. That's what redeem means, to purchase as much of it as we can. Why? Because scripture tells us that the days are evil, they're fleeting. We want to use what we have to intentionally use what God has given to us. Our resource of relationships, people, time, energy, rest, money, whatever it might be, so that we can fulfill God's purpose for our life. So this teaching series, what we've been asking is, God, give me a healthy perspective of all the things that I have in my life. Allow me to use those things. Give me a Jesus perspective over my life. Allow me to use those things for your glory and honor so that I can use them to facilitate your purpose for my life and your will for my life. But let's be honest. As we walk through life, and we maneuver through life, and we try to lead even with the right perspective and focus, life tends to drain us, doesn't it? Doesn't it? There are so many things that are competing for our time, our energy, our family, our lives, our rest, and we easily get run down, don't we? If you're human, your batteries need to be recharged. You find yourself running on empty from time to time. And so the question we have to ask ourselves is, when you and I get to a place of exhaustion, when you feel like you're fighting for your marriage or your relationships or your relationship with God or your kids or whatever it might be, and you feel like there are all these things that are pulling against you, that are wearing you down, what do you do? What fuel do you turn to? What's your source of fuel? I want to start off today by asking us a question, and then I want to define just some terms for us today to get us on the same page. So I'm going to ask us a question today. It's probably going to be pretty unanimous in person and online. It's this question right here. Are you tired? Yeah. Come on, anybody tired? It might be the most response we have all morning. Anybody tired? Is anybody at home tired today? Some of y'all are like, I'm on my third cup of coffee and I can still barely keep my eyes open. I hope this is going to be interesting today, right? Well, what's the word tired mean? Let's look at it. The word tired means in need of sleep or rest. Pretty simple term, right? Anybody in need of some sleep or rest? Come on. Anybody hoping that that Sunday afternoon nap is going to happen today? You're hoping the kids all go down so you can try to catch up on some rest? Well, what's the word rest mean? Rest means to cease work or movement in order to relax, refresh oneself, or recover strength. Some of y'all are like, I need a little extra dose of some rest in my life right now, don't I? I need a little extra rest so that I can cease work because I hate the job that I have anyway. Got to relax a little bit, refresh myself, recover my strength. I think all of us could use a little rest today. I was doing some research this week on rest and sleep. And you know, prior to Thomas Edison inventing the light bulb, the average person slept on average 11 hours a day. Some of y'all are like, what? All of us were like, what? They didn't have kids back then. That's what you're thinking, right? They didn't have kids back then, right? 11 hours, that seems almost like mind-boggling, doesn't it? Right? With the invention of technology, with the invention of the light bulb, all of a sudden people began to stretch their work days where they began to work before sunrise and they would work well beyond sunset. And all of a sudden, time constraints began to get on people and the average sleep time moved to 8 to 9 hours a night. Now, just by happen chance, in 2007, Apple introduced the iPhone. And between 2007 and 2009, the average American went from sleeping 9 hours a night to 7 hours a night. Just coincidentally, with technology, it began to shrink down to 7 hours a night. So the average American now sleeps 7, if they're lucky, 8 hours. But according to the Mayo Clinic, the average person needs at least 9 hours of sleep a night to be considered fully recharged or fully rested. Let's be honest, for many of us, rest doesn't even seem like a possibility. We think rest just means a few days off here or there, a few extra hours of sleep. But let's be honest, once we get into a deficit in our sleep and in our rest, it seems almost impossible to get caught up, doesn't it? That's why you'll go on vacation. And we've often said vacation with kids is not a vacation. You just moved what you do normally at home to another destination, right? And so you come back and you're just as tired. You need time off after the vacation. Listen, rest is a big deal. We live in a culture where we don't reward rest. In fact, we call long hours success. We call long days normal. Professionally, the first one in and the last one out gets rewarded. The one that doesn't take all their vacation time is the one that we call committed. They're the ones that we use as the example. Those that need rest are considered weak. Let me tell you this. The world, society, culture may call lack of rest success, but the Bible calls lack of rest sin. What? Yeah, the Bible says when you don't rest well, when you don't rest correctly, the Bible calls it sin. But the world says it's success. Yeah, but what the world puts a high price tag on is costing all of us way too much. Society and culture is teetering on burnout. That's why anxiety and depression and stress and medications to solve all of those are at the highest in our world's history. Because we keep going back to the same source and expecting it to provide for us what it can. And we're all walking around like zombies trying to numb ourselves through all the different things that our brains will tell us will numb ourselves. So we keep streaming and we keep scrolling and we keep searching and we keep longing and we're looking for something to provide for us the rest and the break and the vacation that our souls and our bodies need. See, we don't rest well. We move past being tired and we move to a place of being depleted. You need more than rest when you become depleted. When you're running on empty, you have to recognize the indicators in your life. Are you able to recognize the indicators in your life when you begin to run on empty? When the fuel gauge begins to flicker in your life and you begin to emotionally and spiritually and physically begin to flicker, what do you do? How do you adjust? Are you even able to recognize when you're running low on fumes? Let me ask you a question today. Are you running on empty? Are you even able to recognize when you are running on empty? Some of you maybe went past empty a long time ago, and you've gone past the reserves, and there's nothing in the tank. Are you even able to recognize it? Are you even able to identify? Are you even able, in the middle of being on empty, to be able to snap yourself out and find some way to refuel yourself? On February 22nd, 1985, a very famous race car driver by the name of Donnie Allison was taking part in the Daytona 500. The Daytona 500 exists of 200 laps. And Donnie Allison was driving a car that was valued at $250,000 in 1985. So just imagine that machinery, that engine today worth well over $1 million. Experienced driver, all experience in the world, incredible NASCAR team, had tasted victory before, but on this day, February 22nd, 1985, he was not recognized for winning the race. In fact, on the third lap of the 200 lap race, his car came to a sputtering stop in the infield. And the reason why is because in all the hustle and bustle of the day, his team had forgotten to put gas in the tank. True story. Now we all laugh, right? We all think, how in the world can this NASCAR team with all this experience and this expensive car and this experienced driver understand the experience of the driver and the cost of the car, and no matter how powerful the engine, it didn't matter because they had simply forgotten to put gas in the tank. And I wonder how many of us get so busy doing life, running kids from one place, heading to school, our careers, whatever it might be, that we don't stop long enough to put the right fuel in the tank. Maybe some of you are trying to add fuel, but again, we go to the wrong source, expecting the things of this world to fuel us in which they were never meant or intended to actually fuel us. In 2019, an individual that will remain nameless may have happened to own a 2000 Ford F-250 that runs on diesel, 7.3 liter, very sought after engine, a very big deal engine. And may have been out with his family one night in the hustle and bustle of life, stopped at Sheets and Graham, let's just say by chance, and filled his truck to the brim, only to start the truck up and move about 10 feet and for the truck to cut off because This individual had put regular in his fuel tank instead of diesel. I don't know who this person was, but this might happen to be his truck right here being put on the back of this tower right here. And let me just tell you something. This was an expensive fatal flaw in my life. I only made this decision one time. I only made this poor decision one time in my life. But I got so busy, just get out, numbless, mindless, just grab a gas can. This isn't my primary vehicle. It's a secondary vehicle. And so you just do what you normally do in routine. You don't really pay attention to it. And you find yourself putting the wrong fuel in the tank. And see, this may not cost you financially. Take it to our life. But when you and I run on the wrong fuel for long enough, it will cost us relationally. It will cost us psychologically. It'll cost us physically. It'll ultimately cost us our relationship with God, because we'll ride around and all of a sudden what happens is that our engine will begin to break down, and it has a cost on our souls and our lives, and it has a cost on the souls and lives of people that matter the most to us. You know, there's a big difference between being tired and depleted. Great cost when we're depleted relationally, emotionally, again, physically, psychologically, and spiritually, and even a greater cost if we don't stop long enough to get refueled. Once depleted, we must fill up with the right things or we'll continue to lead from empty, and it's only a matter of time before you end right back up in the same place all over again. This is coming at a great cost to so many of us in our culture. We look around today at our world, and those of us that call ourselves followers of Jesus, we are fully immersed in the things of the world with maybe our pinky toe in the things of God. And then we wonder why we're not firing all cylinders. And understand this, our spiritual enemy is perfectly content with you and I keeping 9 toes in the world and just 1 in truth, because he knows that you and I will never live at optimal power and potential as long as we depend on the world to provide for us what only God can ultimately provide for us. If you've accepted God as your Lord and Savior of your life, the enemy can accept that. As long as you never live into your full potential, he'll be okay with that. And see, some of us, our homes and our lives will never be the full potential that God has for us, because so many of us are depending on all of the wrong things to fill us and sustain us and to fuel us for the journey ahead. When our vehicles approach empty, again, we get a low fuel indicator or a low fuel light. Again, I asked you earlier, is yours on? Has it been on for a long time? How many of you, when your fuel light goes on, you know exactly how many miles you have left until you run out? How many of you? And how many of you ever played that game and you've gotten burnt? How many of you? Come on. How many of you thought you had a few extra miles only to get on the side of the road, did not have any fuel, right? This is what we do. The fuel light goes off and somebody looks at you and say, are you okay? Nothing to see here, I'm good. But you're like, something doesn't seem right with you today. You seemed a little anxious. You seem kind of stressed out. No. My light's not on. I'm okay. I got plenty in my tank. Don't we play this game? Don't you ever find yourself? I find myself some days. My wife's like, hey, you're a little off today. No, I'm not. I know I'm off. I don't want to admit it, right? I don't want to admit that I'm a little off, that I'm running low, that I might be running out, right? And so we try to hide it. We try to disguise it. Only a matter of time before you break down and you end up snapping on the people that matter. You end up having this full-fledged argument that was so unnecessary. You end up snapping on your kids or your future kids or whatever it might be. Or you just tap out. You walk away from jobs, careers, relationships, marriages, because it's just too much to run on empty for too long. How does our body give us indicators? How does our body flicker to us and tell us the light is going off? Well, a couple words. One of them is fatigue. You ever been fatigued before? Fatigue is when a muscle or the mind has been used almost to the point of failure, and it requires more than normal rest to recuperate. So when you get fatigued, your soul gets fatigued, your mind gets fatigued, your body gets fatigued, right? It says you need something more than just rest. And what you put back in matters. Like if you work out, you want to push your muscles to the point of fatigue. It's part of what you do in a workout. But they tell you what you put in your body immediately after the workout, it matters. So once you get to the point of fatigue, if you put the wrong things in your body, the workout was pointless. You got to fill yourself with the right things. So fatigue is one of them. The next one is this word depleted, right? We talk about depleted. When our inner resources of energy have been drained to the point, again, that much more than rest is required. You see this theme? You see this theme throughout our lives? When we get fatigued, when we get depleted, there is something more than just rest. What does it mean when you and I are depleted, when we are fatigued? Well, how do we know this? We talked a little bit about it. It leads to everything in life becoming overwhelming. You ever been so fatigued, so burnt out, so depleted, that all of a sudden just normal responsibilities begin to overwhelm you? Just normal things. Like getting out of bed and just doing what you normally do. All of a sudden you're so overwhelmed. You're so anxious. You can't even seem to make sense out of the day. What begins to happen? Again, you have lack of patience with the people that matter the most. You just find yourself snapping at people. You're on edge all the time. You find yourself numb to life. There's no joy. There's no happiness. You begin to turn to things looking for an outlet to fill you. And you begin to do things in excess that you normally wouldn't do. And so people begin to overdrink. They begin to overeat. They begin to over-entertain themselves. Why? Because I'm just looking for something. Something to fill me back up. Something to refuel my soul. Something. I'm longing for something. Right? That's what happens so often in our life. What happens most importantly for us as Jesus followers is that when you and I get depleted and fatigued, we no longer represent Jesus well. This is so important. You have to understand, as a Jesus follower, you and I were created with a mission and a purpose. We were created to represent Jesus in all that we say and all that we do. In fact, we were called in Scripture to burn brightly for Him. And when you and I run out of fuel, it's impossible for you and I to continue to burn for Him in any capacity. Listen, you and I are most susceptible to the enemy when you and I are fatigued and depleted because we become so desperate to look for anything to refuel us that we almost always end up turning to the wrong things. I can't reiterate this enough. The right fuel in our life matters. So let me ask you something. Are you empty today? Are you running on low today? Is it time to refuel today? Last term we'll identify today is this word refuel. And for the sake of our conversation, we're going to define it this way. To provide rest with additional fuel. To provide rest with additional fuel in our life. You say, Tad, what do I mean by additional fuel? Well, see, rest will put a little bit of gas back in our tank. But it's only a matter of time before we use all that fuel up again, and we'll have to come back again and back again and back again. We need another type of fuel. As followers of Jesus, we can find rest on our own. But the reality is that you and I were not created to live this life on our own. So as a follower of Jesus, we were called to find our fuel in something, mainly in someone. And so we're going to look at a moment in Scripture today. In a very important moment in Scripture, it's going to be on the Sermon on the Mount, and this is a very important sermon that Jesus teaches. And Jesus is going to liken us, all of us, as followers of Jesus, as lamps and lights. And He's going to talk about why we exist and what we burn for and what's important to us in our lives. If you've been watching The Chosen series, season 3 is going to kick off with this sermon right here. It's all set up to the Sermon on the Mount. I can't wait to watch it. It's going to kick off with the Sermon on the Mount. Very important moment. Jesus is going to speak to Jesus' followers. And when He speaks, and when I read these words to you today, I want you to envision for a moment that Jesus is present in front of you, and He's saying these words to you. I'm not pretending to be Jesus. I'm not pretending to be the voice of Jesus. But I just want you to envision and picture the voice of Jesus as He's speaking this to you. Because He wants you to know that you are a Jesus follower. You are a disciple of His. And you and I were not supposed to look like the rest of the world. We said this. We are not supposed to burn like the rest of the world. We are not supposed to act like the rest of the world. Darkness is not supposed to invade our lives like the rest of the world. We are not supposed to be tied with all of our emotion to what's happening in Washington. That's not supposed to fuel our souls. In fact, Jesus was not a social media warrior. It's why the Jews hated Him. In fact, it is the reason why they crucified Jesus, because He didn't fight political battles. He came for His Father's mission. He says, when you and I get engaged in political wars and nonsense and the things of the world that aren't what I came for, you will find yourself depleted and burnt out. And I wonder how many people's souls are burnt out over the last 48 hours through social media and news. And God's like, you keep turning to the wrong source. Fox News is not the source. CNN is not the source. Donald Trump is not the source. Bernie Sanders is not the source. AOC is not the source. I'm stepping on people's Jesus right now. That's the scary part. This is where we are. 9 toes in the world. 1 toe in truth. 9 toes in social media. 1 toe in the truth. This is the problem with our world. This is the problem with the church culture in America. We are more concerned about the issues of the world than the issues of faith and truth. And if the church does not wake up, the church will continue to lose its voice in a world where we are just crowded in by the noise and chaos and calamity of a world that's getting more insane and more crazy. And if you know the book, all of this is supposed to happen. So why are we freaking out? The world is supposed to eat itself and destroy itself. But in the end, we win. Jesus wins. He reigns. So pull ourselves out of the madness. It breaks my heart. So many people, their emotions, their souls are tied. Our soul is supposed to be anchored to the truth. And the truth is Jesus. Let me stop preaching for just a minute. Let's get into the word. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 through 16. I love the way the message puts it because, again, it would be just like Jesus standing before you today. He says, let me tell you why you're here. Let me tell you why you showed up. Let me tell you why you tuned into Hope Church Online today. You are here to be salt seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? He says, when you and I so mix ourselves with the rest of the world, how can anybody even see that God is in us? He says, at that point, you've lost your usefulness and you'll end up in the garbage, AKA you're of no value to me any longer. You just become like everybody else. Here's another way to put it. You're here to be a light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. He says, we're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? He says, if I called you to shine light, I'm not going to cover you up and tell you to blend in like everybody else. He says, I'm putting you on a light stand. Now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, do what you're supposed to do. Shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. He says, we were given one mission, and that was to burn brightly for him. In the midst of all the calamity and chaos of this world, to point people to the truth of God's love and mercy and grace, and to be about the mission of God. He says, then people will know the goodness of God. Not through how we vote, not through our side of the aisle, but through who God is, through a heavenly Father is, how he cares about his people. As a light, let me ask you something. Is your light burning out? Is it going dim? Is it flickering today? Maybe it's burnout. Maybe your light was never truly lit. You can never ignite your life without the right fuel. And you won't keep your light lit without the right fuel. Great example of this is the disciples. Jesus' closest followers, his closest friends. They had the amazing privilege to stay incredibly fueled up because they got to walk with Jesus, lock arms with him, talk with him, have deep conversations with him. And while he's on this earth, man, they are so on fire. They are so fueled up because he is just literally pumping fuel into their veins. They're watching him do the impossible. He's teaching them the value of where they draw their strength from, because we looked all throughout this teaching series that Jesus regularly got away and refueled himself in his Father's presence. So they're watching all this happen. And as they stay fueled in him, all of a sudden, Jesus, the perfect one, the sinless one, is falsely accused of a crime he did not commit. He's sentenced to death by crucifixion. He's put on a cross. He's crucified for the sins of the world. And all of a sudden, their source of power, their source of strength, all of a sudden, the one they were drawing from, all of a sudden, they're exposed. As Jesus exits this earth after his resurrection, all of a sudden, they go back to life as they know it, right? Because they've lost their source of strength. They don't know how to fill themselves. They don't have the power or strength. They've been riding off the coattails of Jesus's power and strength. I think for many of us, we can relate, because many of us struggle outside of Sunday mornings or whenever we consume a message online. We struggle with really learning how to fill ourselves with the power and strength of God on our own. So disciples are struggling with the same thing in their life. So after the resurrection, Jesus makes himself present to these people. And he tells them, he says, listen, I need you to understand something. You guys don't have the strength and power to do this by yourself. He says, here's what I'm gonna ask you to do. I'm gonna ask you to go to a filling station in Jerusalem. I'm gonna ask you to go to the nearest sheets in Jerusalem. Go to the second floor. And I want you to stay there until the fuel shows up. I need you to stay put. Because if you leave this room, you will instantly engage in the world and you realize you don't have what it takes. I need you to stay put because I'm going to give you something, something that was far greater than me. In fact, I want to tell you the secret. What empowered me is now going to be made available to you. And it's going to give you the fuel and the power that this world cannot give you if you'll just sit tight and wait for it. So the question today is this. How do we keep our lamps lit? How do we keep our lives burning? How do we remain a light in the middle of darkness? Well, the first thing is this, is that we must be filled with the right fuel. We have got to make a conscious decision today that I'm going to fill my life with the right fuel. It says in Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4, on the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm. And it what? It. Come on, it. It filled the house. All of a sudden, there was a supernatural feeling in the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was with the, with the, with the. So as Jesus followers, what are we supposed to be full of? Not a trick question. The world, media, news, we're supposed to be full of the Holy Spirit. It's our job. This verse won't be on the screens, but Ephesians 5:18 says, don't be drunk with wine. It's not just speaking about wine in this moment. It's saying, don't be drunk on the world. Don't find other avenues and other sources. It says, but be filled by the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 4, verse 31 says, after this prayer, the meeting place shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Then they preached the word of God with boldness. We see all throughout Scripture that the followers of Jesus were filled in a moment, but then they were continually filled and refueled by the power of the Holy Spirit. So how do we keep our lamps lit? How do we do that, right? We must have the right fuel in our life. The next thing is this, we must continually be filled and refilled. Peter's a great example of this. If you go read in the book of Acts, Peter's one of Jesus' disciples. He is filled with the Holy Spirit. And it tells us immediately he goes out and preaches. And immediately they see over 3,000 people in one sermon give their lives to Jesus. Immediately after Peter preaches, he goes and he prays to be filled with the Holy Spirit again. He just filled in the room in Acts 2. Then he goes back and asks to be filled again. In Acts chapter 3, this is the first time that we see disciples healing anyone in the name of Jesus. A lame man comes to Peter and asks to be healed, and Peter stops and he prays that the Holy Spirit will fill him and give him the strength to heal this lame man. Now in Acts chapter 4, we see that Peter is brought in front of the Sanhedrin, which was the religious rule of the day, and he's put on trial because he has healed a man in the name of Jesus. Now remember, the disciples were the men just a few chapters ago who were hiding in the shadows, terrified to stand before anyone and admit they're Jesus followers. And all of a sudden, in Acts 4, it says the Sanhedrin were astonished of the boldness of Peter because they realized that he had been in the presence of Jesus. Where did it come from? It tells us before they went in front of the Sanhedrin, Peter got back on his knees and prayed for a fresh feeling of the Holy Spirit in his life. In other words, each time before the next mission, before the next task, they asked God for a fresh feeling of his Spirit for whatever particular task. And notice that God gave them just enough, not too much, not more than enough, but just enough to complete the task at hand. This is how God works. Maybe you've heard it said before that at every new level comes a whole nother devil. You ever heard that before? Don't we all aspire for the next rung, the next thing, the next house, the next whatever, the next raise? But don't we discover that every new rung is a whole nother set of responsibilities and struggles and difficulties and hardships and setbacks, so much we see in life. Bring it into the spiritual realm. Let me say this. Yesterday's fuel might have gotten you to today's destination, but you're going to have to be refueled again tomorrow to get to where God has next for you. The simplest way I can put it is that God will give you enough today for today's obstacles and struggles and battles. And God will give you enough tomorrow for tomorrow's struggles, obstacles, and battles. Let me let you know a little secret. He intentionally set it up that way. He intentionally created you and I to run out because he knew this. I know this is like a mind bender. He's God and we're not. And he created us so that we would be utterly dependent on him. So what he desires is that every single day we would come fresh and anew and we say, God, refill us. Yes, we always have a relationship with God through the Holy Spirit, but we need to continually come back and invite him to continue to fill us again. Because yesterday, man, I burned some fuel and I'm gonna burn some more fuel today. And if I don't make a regular practice of being refilled, then I will continue to cruise and I'll wait until I run out. And damage is already beginning to be done before I run back and then I say, clean up my mess. And God's like, break the cycle. Start each day asking God to fill you up and to refuel you because he will. How many of you grew up in church? Come on, how many of us in person online, how many grew up in church? How many of you made it grow up in church but you went to Vacation Bible School? How many of us? How many of you ever remember singing the song? I should get Brian up here really quick, but give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning, burning, burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Y'all remember the song? Give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning, burning, burning. Keep me burning till the break of day, right? Y'all remember that song? I tried to get the band to sing it this morning. Nobody was behind that right now. I was like, no, we're not singing that song, right? But think about that song. Give me oil in my lamp. Why? To keep me burning, burning, burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning, burning, burning. Keep me burning till the break of day. It doesn't say give me burning through the rest of my life. It doesn't even say keep me burning till tomorrow. It says give me enough oil in my lamp to burn today. Then I'm going to come back tomorrow and I'm going to sing that same song. Give me oil. Give me fuel. All throughout scripture, the Holy Spirit is directly tied to oil. It's a symbolism of his strength and power. So what I need is a daily dose of his oil in my life, or I will begin to burn with the wrong fuel. And when I begin to burn with the wrong fuel, I'll begin to tap out. I don't know about you. Romans 12:11 says this, don't burn out, but keep yourselves fueled and aflame. I have one responsibility as a follower of Jesus, and that's not to burn out. My job is to make frequent trips to the filling station. As a Jesus follower, if I call myself a Jesus follower, if I'm not refueled, if I'm not replenished, if I'm not recharged, then I will burn out. I will burn out. It's only a matter of time. If I'm connected to the wrong source, it's only a matter of time before that source does not provide for me what I need. And many of you know this, because many of you, your story is my story. You went to the world as a source, and you tried business and finances and relationships and sex and drugs and alcohol, whatever is out there, right? And you tried to get all of it from that source only to discover that source will never provide for you what only God can. And we know that. And then we receive God as the source, and yet we keep running back to the world to do for us what the world could never do for us. A couple years ago, we moved into our house. It was like 2015. And in 2016, we started noticing we were having some water pressure issues in our house. And so, like, if my wife was running the dishwasher or washing some clothes, maybe the water pressure in the shower would get really low. And then there came some moments as it started to progress where, like, if she was running the dishwasher and getting the shower, there'd be no water. And then it came some days we would have, like, no water at all, and the next day we would have water, and it was crazy. And so we brought somebody out, they looked at our well, and they were like, man, your family's just too big. This well cannot produce enough water to sustain the Duggar family that you guys have. And so they're like, you either got to get rid of some kids or you're going to have to like dig a new well. And so we were like, I don't know. Like it's kind of kind of up in the air. What are we going to do? So we're like, okay, well, I guess we'll dig a new well. And so they came out to dig a new well. And have you ever watched them come out and identify where water is? So a guy comes out with two copper wires and he walks through my yard and the wires just cross and he's like, we're going to dig right there. And I'm like, this, who came up with this? You know what I mean? Like, this for real right now? Like, this is crazy, right? And as he's telling me this, he's telling me the house they just left, they had just dug four wells in which none of them had water. I'm like, how am I going to trust your wire system, bro? Like, this is crazy, right? And so they charge by the foot. So I'm sitting on the front porch, and every time they add a new sleeve to this drill, it's 6 foot. And so I'm just timing by six every time that they do this. And I'm just wondering how we're going to pay for this because I don't have an unlimited resource in the bank account, right? And so it just keeps going, and we got down to about 140 feet. And I'm sitting there on the front porch like, we got about 5 feet left, and we're broke, right? That's just the truth. And he looks at me and goes, we're about to hit water. And I'm like, okay. You told me that 10 feet ago, but okay. And he hits water, like in the next foot. And it begins to gush, and he runs over to me, and he says, man, we hit a gusher. I'm like, okay. He's like, it's a 14-gallon a minute gusher. I said, what does that mean? And so what that means is that you just tapped into a well in which your lifetime, you will never use all the water in this well. It'd be impossible for you to utilize all this water. And I'll say that you and I have a resource, an unlimited resource given to us by God through the Holy Spirit. And he says, listen, it will never run dry. You keep going to things that constantly fail you and keep running you dry, but I have given you an unlimited resource to tap into that will fill you and refill 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 you. No matter how depleted, no matter how stressed out, no matter how anxious you are, will fill you over and over and over again. The times in my life that I've burned out have been the times that I've allowed myself to get so busy that I haven't been full of the right stuff. Some people have told me that I'm full of a lot of other stuff, if you know what I'm saying. And sometimes that stuff creeps into my life, right? Let's just be honest. I've had to pull back in those moments of burnout and exhaustion. I'm gonna talk a lot about this next week and really begin to evaluate really what I've allowed myself to fill myself with and convince myself with that'll fill me. See, just as a burnout lamp produces no light, neither does a burnout follower of Jesus. My life loses purpose when it's not burning brightly for him, when it's not shining bright. If the signs of burnout are noticeable, you've got to pay attention to them. Some of us, our lives have been flickering and flickering and flickering, and flickering is usually a sign that your life is teetering towards burnout, or maybe your life is not burning at the right pace. You ever heard the statement, you gotta trim your lamp? You ever heard this? If anybody ever had an oil lamp, they tell you gotta trim the lamp. See, sometimes a lamp's wick will be too high. And when it's too high, when it's too exposed, it burns too much, which means it's burning more fuel than it should, than it was created to. And it'll cause a flame to flicker because it's not burning at the right pace. So if you own a lamp, sometimes you would have to come and you'd have to trim the lamp so there's just enough exposed to give the right amount of light and to burn at the right pace. You know what this means? There are moments when my life begins to flicker when I realize I'm too exposed. There's too much going on in my life. There's too much chaos. And those are the moments that I have a suitable helper, my wife, Becky. I have people around me that love and care about me that I want them to look at me and say, hey, something's flickering in your life. You need to cut some things back. You need to dial some things back. You need to trim the wick of your life. You need to cut some things back in your life. How many of us right now, maybe the indicator has been going off for far too long and we've been ignoring it? Stop and let God refuel you. You're his lamp. He wants you to burn for him. But if you never have burned with the right fuel, then you don't even know what you're missing and you're utilizing the wrong source. Again, the Holy Spirit is your source. He has come to be your ultimate source. We were never intended to burn this life without him. Let me close with an illustration that Jesus gives in Matthew chapter 25. And I don't want to get you lost in the imagery. Jesus is trying to tell a story about when he returns, but he's telling a story about how to prepare in this life for him coming back. Because I don't know if you know this, but we believe Jesus is coming back one day. We believe that we've been purchased, we've been bought, and that this world doesn't define us. We believe in an eternity, a place that's greater than this world. And even though this world has fallen and broken, the hope we have is tied to an eternity in heaven, free of all of the pain and suffering and sin that this world has seen put damage on it. What all the sin has done to our souls and our bodies, we are promised in faith an eternity beyond all of that. And so Jesus tells a story about some bridesmaids and a bridegroom. And in this story, he is referencing us as the bridesmaids and him as the bridegroom. He says that the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. It says the 5 who were foolish took no oil for their lamps, but the other 5 were wise enough to take along extra oil, aka additional fuel for the life. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all lay down and slept. It says at midnight, they were aroused by the shout, "Look at the bridegroom, he's coming. Come out and welcome him." All the bridesmaids got up and they trimmed their lamps. And the 5 foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. So go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." While they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast. And the door was locked. Later, when the other 5 bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Sir, open the door for us." But he called back, "I don't know you." In verse 13, he says, "So stay awake and be prepared because you don't know the day or the hour of when I will return." So what does that mean? It means that a lot of us will sit in places like this and we'll watch messages like this and we'll never allow our lives to truly be in sync with Jesus and have the fuel that he offered us. A lot of us are fooling ourselves because we show up to places like this, but we don't have a real relationship with Jesus. We don't have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. We're not being fueled up. Again, the Bible talks a lot about being lukewarm. It says we're hot or cold. So when we got 9 toes in the world and 1 pinky toe in the truth, I think Jesus would step back and say, "What are you really about? Are you really a follower of mine? Do you really belong to me? Are you running to me as your source, as the ultimate source?" May our lives get to a place like the Apostle Paul, greatest follower of Jesus the world has ever known, who said what? He said, "I'm incredibly weak." He says, "I need to become less and less so that Jesus can become more and more." In fact, John the Baptist said those words in John 3:30. We'll look at those next week. He said, "I got to become less so he can come more because I'm not enough and he is." You say, "I don't want to relate myself to Paul or John the Baptist. How about Jesus?" You know, Jesus didn't begin his public ministry until he was first filled with the Holy Spirit. So Jesus himself, the Son of God, didn't even begin to walk out because why? He knew in my own strength and own power, I'm not enough. I need the power and the source of Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit was given to us as a gift by God to be the source that you and I need. How long are we going to turn to the wrong source? Trying to expect this life and this world to do what it was never designed to do. Can we be honest? Oftentimes, our lives run out because our lives are running with the wrong fuel and the wrong source. My prayer today is that we would just begin to evaluate our lives and our time and what our sources are, and we would begin to surrender and make God the source of our life. Because if we don't burn from him, then unintentionally, we burn for something else. And the world really doesn't need any more so-called followers of Jesus burning for the rage of the world. They need followers of Jesus who are going to burn brightly for the things of God. Let's pray together. God, today, God, we are so thankful that you are our source. God, you are our strength. God, that our power is found in you and you alone. God, we are thankful that, God, without you, God, this life is impossible. God, and as we recognize that, may we get to a place where we become more and more dependent on you. God, because of Jesus, God, we can have a relationship with you. We can know you, but far greater than that, God, we are given the gift of your Spirit inside of us. The same Spirit and power that fueled Jesus is made available to us. It seems so crazy that Jesus would look at his disciples and he'd look at us and he'd say, "You are amazed by my 3 years on this earth?" He tells us these words. He says, "You'll even see even greater things done in my name through you." God, we're just holding on for life, just trying to get through. And God, you have even greater things in store for our lives, our marriages, our homes. God, may we choose to be a light. May we choose to burn for you in all that we say and all that we do. God, we're thankful for who you are today. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. Really, our prayer in this Fuel Calls teaching series is that you and I would truly begin to evaluate what so many things in life are costing us. And again, where our ultimate source of strength and power is. I want to give you just our summer schedule as we move forward. I want to make sure everybody's aware of this. And so don't check out, don't sign off just yet, because this is very important. If you want to get out a phone for just a moment I don't know if you can screenshot this because the font's a little small, but I'm going to walk you through just so you can kind of know what the next few weeks here at Hope Church entail for us. And so as it's already been said, next Sunday is July 3rd. And let's be honest, half of y'all ain't coming to church next weekend if we were in person anyway. So we have this week doing all the heavy lifting. We're going to have a service online for everybody. It's going to be amazing. We're going to be out at the lake. Amazing service for you next week. We're going to wrap up this 2 o'clock teaching series for you. And so we want to invite you to be part of it at 9:30 a.m. and 11 a.m. next week. And then beginning July 10th, Sunday to July 10th, we are entering into our five-week summer schedule. And so our goal and mission is to allow our church to live out what we've talked about in this Fuel Calls teaching series. I don't know if you realize this, but it takes a ton of volunteers to pull off two services every single week. And we are just a few weeks away, hard to believe, from fall being here, and fall is rapidly approaching. And so we have a lot of people on vacations, a lot of people that need some time off. And so for 5 weeks, which is July 10th through August the 7th, we're gonna be at one service at 10 a.m. only. July 10th through August the 7th. July 10th through August the 7th. One service only, 10 a.m. in person and online. Then August the 14th, we come back. That's Move Up Sunday. And so if you have a kid that's in preschool moving up to an elementary age, or all of your elementary age kids or students, that's a big day here, a big celebration day, Move Up Sunday. We'll go back to our regular scheduled program, but our services will be at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. All this is going to be an email, all right? Send it out to you later this week. Let me say one last thing. July 10th, when we come back in person at 10 a.m. only on July 10th, right? It's Hope Kids Takeover Sunday. It's going to be an awesome day. You're not going to miss it. Last time we pulled off Hope Kids Takeover Sunday, it was me and some of the staff, and all of our Hope Kids staff were not in town. And so next week, the amazing Kay Thomas, Joshua Thomas, the whole kids team are going to be in here putting on a phenomenal, phenomenal day. You don't want to miss it. And let me tell you this, everybody in attendance is going to get a free ticket to the Sock Puppets game Sunday night, July 10th at 6 p.m. So we're all going back to the ballpark Sunday night, July 10th at 6 p.m., we're going to hang out the game together. So everybody in attendance is going to get a free ticket. And I even heard a rumor that Sock Squash, which is the Sock Puppet mascot, may or may not be in attendance that day. I don't know. You have to come find out. We had a bunch of great stuff happening after the service. We want to invite you back. So that's our summer schedule. We'll get an email out to you. I know all of you have that memorized. I'll ask all of you out in the lobby today what all the dates are. You'll forget all of it. Listen, we love you guys. Have an awesome week. Have a great 4th of July. If you're on vacation, get refueled, get rested. We'll see you online next week. Have a great day. Thank you so much.
Still found a reason to praise. never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean.
So clear what it's all about.